Hi everyone. So today we'll be listening to the joy of volunteering with open technology and culture. So basically what I'm trying to tell you in this presentation is that how to volunteer, how to reach out to people, how to bring volunteers into your project, and what kind of problems you might encounter as a mentor and how to solve them. So my name is Neta Hussain, and I'm affiliated to Wikimedia India chapter. Wikimedia India is an affiliate of the Wikimedia Foundation, which is the organization that runs Wikipedia and its sister projects. I've been volunteering with Wikimedia for the last 4 years, and yes, still surviving. I've not been paid. I'm not an intern there, so I just do the volunteering part. Mostly I do the content writing. Like I'm a medical student who is at the final year of studies. So there is so much of medicine stuff that I'm reading. So I write all this content into Wikipedia, and I expand articles and I create new articles. In between, I also do a little outreach. Like I reach out to people in my locality and I talk about my Wikipedia experience. I also mentor them to join Wikipedia as volunteers. Of late, I've also been volunteering with the Mozilla Foundation, again as a volunteer. There I do mostly localization. Like for Mozilla, the Mozilla browser has to be generated in like all languages, right? You want to have the browser in your local language, you want to have it in English. So there will be like Mozilla browsers are available in like many different languages. So I do the localization part for the Indian language called Malayalam. Again, I've also been volunteering for TED Talks. Probably you have heard TED Talks. So I'm the language manager for the Indian, again the same Indian language, and I translate stuff from English to Malayalam language, and I also encourage other people to do the same. So in summary, I will just be running you through about how to mentor volunteers and why I think volunteering is fun. And also I'll just give you a few ideas on best practices in conducting outreach events and where you can go wrong and what you can do to put it right. So the first part of the question. So how to mentor volunteers? Like first you need to, I'll put it in like four different sections. Like you've got to find them. Like it's the volunteers don't come to you. You have got to find them. You have got to go to them. You have got to make them understand that it's really a valuable project. And next step is to teach them. You have to make them understand what they actually have to do. Like it's not enough that you bring them, but you have to teach them what to do. And second and third is to engage them. Like in Wikipedia, for instance, if you want to have them engaged, you want to make them write content, you want to make them conduct outreach events themselves and so on. And yes, sustain them. Like, so if you conduct an outreach event today and say you teach them and you do the rest of the three steps, and if they are not going to sustain, all your work, all your effort will be wasted, and you have to give them sustained motivation to be able to contribute again and again. So finding them. First, whenever I conduct a new event, I always ask people why they have decided to volunteer, why they have decided to be a volunteer. And I used to get like very curious answers, sometimes funny answers. So I classified all the answers which I get under four headings, four subheadings. So when I ask people, they say that they volunteer to make a difference, like they want to change the world. They want to make sure that their presence in this world is felt. Like everybody died, right? So at the end of the life, like if you feel like your life was really worth living it, you should definitely be doing something that helps people. So people do that to make a difference. And some people say that they need to gain a lot of skills and experience. Or mostly these people are like students and interns who are looking for gaining more experience in working with something. For example, I have known journalists who write on Wikinews. Wikinews is a sister project of Wikipedia, which has people writing news articles into it. So there are budding journalists who write articles on Wikinews. There are students who write articles on Wikipedia and so on. So in doing that, they are actually gaining new skills. They are gaining a lot of experience. So some people volunteer to gain skills and experience. Again, it's really lovely to network with peers of similar interests. If you're writing on Wikipedia and suppose you're writing articles related to medicine, it's very likely that you run into other people who are also doing the same thing. So you make friends with them, you socialize with them, you get in touch with them on social media, and you become friends with them. So some people like to hang out with people who have similar interests as they have, and that makes them volunteer. And some people say, yeah, they just volunteer for fun because they have got a lot of free time, like probably every weekend is free for them. So they think that just like they are playing guitar, like, or like they are going to the music classes, they find Wikipedia as another means to have fun, just a different way of, just a change of routine from their daily activities. So some people volunteer for fun. So these are the four very popular answers which I get when I ask people why they are volunteering. Now, yes, so the first question which every mentor should ask would be like where they should find their own volunteers. I have found the best of the volunteers at the most unexpected of the places. I could cite an example. We have had a conference of Wikipedians happening in a city, in a nearby city. And we all were traveling, and a few of us, like it's like a bunch of people, like five or six of us were traveling to attend the conference, and we were traveling on the train. And we were all wearing Wikipedia t-shirts. And we were all making a celebration out of the traveling. We were all talking about Wikipedia projects and so on. So the people in the whole railway compartment got really very interested in what's going on, and they kept asking us about like, what do you do, and what is your project, and so on. So there we got a couple of volunteers who were interested in volunteering. So on the train, we demonstrated them how to edit Wikipedia, and they were really very interested in contributing, and one of them is still a very active contributor. Again, another instance, when we were traveling on flight to another country to participate in another conference, we were like on the flight, we were like making a lot of fuss, like we were talking a lot about Wikipedia. And thankfully, the flight crew did not think that we were terrorists or something. And we also had the flight crew join us. We said we are Wikipedia people and so on. We gave them stickers and so on. So they were all very happy, and we did so much of outreach there. So it's always better, it's always good to expect a potential volunteer anywhere. So it's good to wear your Wikipedia t-shirt, or maybe when you're going out, you could talk with a bystander standing there and talk about, you know, general things and also about Wikipedia, and you might find a volunteer there. Then we do go to schools, universities, and workplaces. I think schools are the best place to get people started because you get a lot of people together there. And in the school, students do have a lot of time to volunteer because they have been studying, and they also get their annual breaks during which they, I think that's a perfect time to start volunteering. Also, that is also the best time to inculcate the value of volunteering, because once you grow old, and once you have a lot of, once you get a good job, and once you are very busy with the rest of your, the rest of the things in your life, it's unlikely that you find time for volunteering. So I think the schools and universities and workplaces do really make a real start to find volunteers for your project. Then also, I have found people like volunteers on social media and blogs. We make friends with a lot of people on social media, and actually sometimes I don't really know them personally, but we are like good social friends on maybe Facebook or maybe Google Plus and so on. So when you keep sharing posts about your Wikimedia outreach activity or your Mozilla outreach activity, they become interested and they come for your next event and they start volunteering with you. So I found that sharing news, spreading the word about your programs, spreading the word about getting started, really helps if you start with a social media. And that's what you can do when you're sitting at your home, right? You don't have to go out. You can just be blogging, or you can be writing posts on your Facebook page and so on. Yeah, so I have had people who attended many outreach workshops and said that they find it difficult to continue. They find it difficult to be volunteers. So I've asked them why. Why do they feel that they should discontinue volunteering why should they feel that it's too hard to be a volunteer? So these are the reasons they give. I classified it into, you know, points. Some people say that they have too little time, they are too busy with their studies, they have their exams, they have to spend a long time working on their code and so on. So they are being too busy and they are unable to volunteer. So I think being busy is a state of mind. If you want to find time for doing something, you can actually find it. So it's about setting priorities. Sometimes I work with them to help them to create a timetable, to help them find free time for volunteering, but it works only sometimes. It doesn't work all the time. Again, some people think that editing or coding or writing content is really too hard, and some people are really very intimidated to write on Wikipedia, thinking that if you write on Wikipedia and you save the page, and suppose you make a very silly mistake, the whole world is going to see it. So they are really very intimidated to be able to contribute to a project which, you know, which shows up in front of anyone who is opening up the internet. So I tell them that they have to be bold. They do not need to care about making mistakes, because Wikipedia is all about rewriting the content, and if at all you make a mistake, it can be like reverted. But that too doesn't work all the time, because people are like really very intimidated to be able to do something which is out of their comfort zones. Then there is this issue of lacking self-confidence. So I think it's a subset of people who think that writing content is too hard also lack self-confidence. If you lack self-confidence, you are never going to, you know, achieve anything. So that's something which you have to work as a personality trainer maybe, and not actually as a Wikimedia mentor. But then it's an issue which every mentor should address too. And I don't really know how to, you know, address this. And probably if any of you have ideas, I'll definitely be able to take some points from you. Next thing is, people do not sometimes have access to resources. Say if you're writing a Wikipedia article, you might want to look up libraries, you might want to look up resources which are not always free. So if you do not have access to them, you will not be able to contribute to the article of your choice or to the project of your choice. So, and there are people like people who do not have their own laptops or do not have access to their internet, especially in back in India where I come from. So lack of access to resources is really a very big issue when it comes to conducting outreach, at least in my locality. So I think I'll discuss about solving this problem in the coming few slides. Then there is this communication and language barriers. Because most of cheat sheets and the help guides, all these are available in English and in most of the major world languages, and not in all these regional languages. So so we mentor them, we tell them what to do and so on, but there's only until a point which you can do it. Later on, you want to make them learn on their own. So if they do not have access to stuff written in their own language, it will be really very hard for them to keep up with volunteering. So I have had people drop out because they do not have stuff, enough of help resources coming in their own language. Also, sometimes if they are a native speaker of a different language and they are not very familiar with English, they are not able to communicate with the global community. And that makes it hard for them to collaborate and do projects in a global level. This is a very personal question which I often get to answer. Because I come from a medical school, I come from India, I come from an area where we have too less access to internet, like you get a very slow internet. And it's not very often that people use the internet even for the studies. So I've never thought of answering this question until 2012, when the Wikimedia Foundation itself asked me this question for their annual fundraising banners. As a medical student, we always used to have to refer to English textbooks because the learning medium is English. And these textbooks happen to be very expensive. So I never used to buy all of them. So I used to use the library resources. I used to make notes on my own. I also used the Wikipedia to find out so much because I could refer to Wikipedia while I'm at home. I don't need to go to the library all the time. So in the process, I found that some of the articles in Wikipedia are inadequate and they require content. So I had notes of my own. So I thought, why not upload my own notes? Why not write down? Why not expand the existing articles with my own notes? And that was how I got started. And ever since, I've been doing the same stuff, and I'm not at all tired by doing this. In fact, I'm getting more excited every other day because I'm finding more and more opportunities with Wikimedia to volunteer. After finishing off with the writing, I thought I should be also doing some outreach because I should encourage other people to engage into Wikipedia, and that was how I got into the outreach. Now, about conducting workshops, about teaching people. So I'm not here to bring you through the step-by-step guide of conducting workshops, but I can definitely share you a very few points on what worked and what did not work. And I think these are really precious learnings, at least according to me, because I learned it by I have made all these mistakes, and I've done things I've done stuff to minimize all these mistakes. And even now, I'm not really a very experienced mentor or a very experienced outreach Wikimedian. But even then, I think all these points do really work when it comes to my case. My first point is participation by invitation. We look at conducting workshops for, say, 40 people or maybe 50 people, not more than that, because we might not be able to handle the large audience. So we might get maybe 100 people who are interested in participating in the workshop, and you have to be selective about it. So if you just open up your workshop to the public, there will be more people who will be coming to wanting to attend your session, and you don't really have space to accommodate them. So what we do is we open up the participation by invitation. What I usually do is create a Google form and ask them to write down their basic details. And I also ask two questions. First question is, what is their motivation in attending the workshop? And the second question is, what is their level of expertise with Wikipedia? And by looking at their answers, I'll figure out what their level of motivation is, and I invite them, I select the participants to attend based on their opinions. Second one is to create a leaderboard. A leaderboard can be advantageous and disadvantageous at the same time, because when you're conducting a group workshop and you're making everybody to edit, if you're creating a leaderboard, it will show you the edit counts of, the level of activity of everybody who is participating, and the level of activity is measured by the number of edits they make on, that particular category which they are working on. So leaderboard can be good and bad, because it can be good if you're working with a homogeneous group of people, like a Wikipedia school club, where all participants share the same level of interest and same level of knowledge about Wikipedia. So it can really create a sense of healthy competition among them and make them work harder, so that their name comes on top of the list. So everybody wants to be the winner, right? So if their name wants to come to be on the top of the list, they have to be more engaging. So the leaderboard works there. But it doesn't work in cases where you have a diverse interest group, like people who are beginners, people who are intermediate, and people who are advanced, because the advanced people are always going to be the leaders, who are going to be the top of the leaderboard. And the beginners would absolutely find it very difficult to cross them, and they will get discouraged, and finally they might give up. So we have to use this tool very cautiously, but it sometimes really works in promoting healthy competition. My third point is to mix the newcomers with veterans. When you conduct events, there would be at least in a group of 50, maybe you will get three or four people who have edited Wikipedia before. Those people would have some knowledge about what should be happening in the event. And if you mix them with the newcomers, it would be really helpful for the newcomers because they can also do some sort of mentoring with all these people, and they can get acquainted with all the newcomers and maybe like develop a mentorship, I mean develop like a friendship among each other. And so, and also the experienced editor could later be contacted and made the mentor of, you know, all these newcomers. And next is about repeating events. So if you conduct an event one day, and yeah, everybody will be fine, people will listen to you, they'll be very happy knowing all the basics of editing and so on. And they never show up later on. Maybe they'll quit because of some of the reasons I told previously. So to keep them engaged, it would be really good to repeat the event at the same venue with the same number of participants who had participated in the previous event, with a different schedule, with a different agenda. Like if the first event was about a really basic training class, the second event could be about a little advanced stuff. So in repeating events, we are like engaging them, we are making editing as a routine practice for them, so that sometimes that mostly works. Then yes, less is good. Because suppose you're looking at conducting a 6-hour Wikipedia workshop, and you will feel like teaching them everything about editing Wikipedia in these 6 hours. You will pack up the whole schedule with stuff, like you start from the beginning, you start from the basics, but you would want to tell them everything about the style guide, you would want to tell everything about the editing mechanisms and so on. So that will really make them exhausted. There is only an optimum amount of information that you can put into their brains during a specific period of time. So let's be giving them, you know, a specific amount of just enough information that they can process, and do not just jam a lot of information about editing. So that works. Again, it's very important to ask for feedback. Like at the end of the event, I make it a habit to ask them. Sometimes I give them a survey form about what aspects of the edit, aspects of the event could be improved, and what aspects I need to put more stress into, which helps me in designing the coming events. And seventh is the anti-harassment policy. This is very important. In most of the events we conduct, we might not. Some people might actually be not very comfortable dealing with their peers who might maybe abusive to them. We never know. And as mentors, we never know because we are dealing with a large crowd. So it's important to have an anti-harassment policy, and also tell them that we do have an anti-harassment policy. And again, also point out a person, a very mature, a very good person, and point out that person and say that this is the person you can approach to if you have faced any harassment issues. So this is really very important, because sometimes people really do not feel confident enough to speak up about their harassment issues, and you might lose a volunteer just because they find the project being, they find the whole atmosphere being too fighty, too very uncomfortable for them. 8 is to go slow. Like, as experienced editors, we feel, for us it's really very easy to create articles. We do it very quickly. We do it in 10 minutes. Probably if you are a very experienced editor, you can create a new article in 5 minutes. If you are going in our own pace, you are never going to educate your volunteers. You are never going to educate the newcomers. So to educate them, if you want to educate them, if you want to be a good teacher, you have to go in their own pace. You have to understand what speed they are comfortable at. But probably you'll get to know about it. When you start the workshop, you can ask them like about their familiarity levels with the internet and their familiarity levels with Wikipedia to know at what speed you should go to. Again, ask your participants questions and encourage answers from them. Because even if we are giving a very perfect talk, even if we are giving a very quite understandable talk, we might never know if your audience are capturing your stuff. So in between, feel free to ask questions to them and get answers from them to be sure that they're actually following you and you are in their pace. 10th is to not intimidate. So sometimes we start by saying that it is very hard to edit Wikipedia, it's very hard to do this, and so on. So if you start by intimidating them, you are never going to get a good volunteer out of them. So in the beginning, you should be like, hey, come on, it's a very fun activity. Let's do it together. It's a very collaborative stuff. And here you have got a cool bunch of mentors and so on. It will make them confident to be editing. Or if they're intimidated, you are not going to get a good volunteer out of them. 11th is to spread the word. Suppose you're conducting an event and you do not reach out to enough people, you might not even make the numbers you're expecting to. So before the event, like at least 2 weeks before the event, you should be going on telling people. Probably if you're conducting it in a university, you can stick the notices on the prominent notice boards. You could also put things on social media. Maybe you can create an event page on Facebook and so on. That will help very much in spreading the word. Then 12th is to document everything. It's really very hard to document because if you're conducting like a large number of events, it's hard to be documenting everything. But it really works when you want to look back and reflect on what has happened. And this is where you can be learning a lot about what mistakes you have made and what mistakes you should avoid in the future. Especially if you're getting a grant from a particular organization to conduct a workshop, you might want to write a report to them. So it's best to include all your learnings into the report and make it a make it a perfect document. So documenting everything, though it's really very hard, it does work most of the time. And 13th is to expect surprises. The best surprise I have ever had was to go to a college to conduct an event, and I came to know that there's no event happening. So all this stuff happens. So sometimes everything doesn't work, but you have to be expecting surprises most of the time. It's not always possible that everything you plan happens there. So you should plan well, but at the same time, you should be there to expect surprises. And 14th is to look at the numbers. So when you get like 100 applicants wanting to attend your event, you might have the tendency to have them all together, put them all together, and to conduct the event. But please don't do that. If you are like the only mentor doing it, I would probably suggest you put 20 people together, and you cannot handle more than 20 people if you are the single mentor running it. And if you have like 2 or 3 mentors, maybe you can go until 50 or 60 and not more than that. It's really very hard to capture everybody's attention all at the same time if you have got a large audience. So in conducting outreach events, you have 2 options. You can either play the number game or you can play the volume game. If you're playing the volume game, it's like you are bringing a lot of people and not so many people will be distracted. You won't be able to grab the attention of everyone and you're going to quite lose a lot of people. Playing the number game is good, like you're conducting more and more events and you're creating the participant size of each event very less, and that will have more of engagement between the audience and the speaker, and that helps. And next is the women-only workshops. Especially in India, where violent crimes against women is on the high, some women do not find it very comfortable to be interacting with men while they're conducting the workshop. I don't know if it's true for most of the cultures, but when I do conduct women-only workshops, women are more encouraged to speak compared to an all-gender workshop. So if you're conducting an event in a women-only university, for example, it would be definitely good to keep it women-only so that women turn up in large numbers. So women have a sense of security that they don't have to be in a mixed atmosphere, and they tend to speak out more and they tend to interact more when there are only other women in the room. Again, in your about additional opportunities, like if you're conducting an event, you should also be telling about other opportunities where you can volunteer other than the project you're working in, because you never know what project which a person will be interested in. So we could also tell a little bit about other projects. Again, we should also tell them about internship opportunities. The kind of internship opportunities which I always tell them are the outreach program for women, about which maybe Marina will be able to tell you. Marina, please, will be able to tell you. I also tell them of the Google Summer of Code. These are the these are the opportunities which they might be applying into. So there have been people who have applied to these programs because after hearing it for the first time from me, which makes me really very proud. And yes, in organizing an event, one has to plan in advance. So if you are, the planning, if you're only looking at mentoring, speaking at the event, you might need only like a 2 weeks time before the actual event. So that you can put everything in place. But if you're also looking at the logistics, probably you have to start a little early. Again, over-prepare, overdo everything. You don't know what to expect. Like once you reach there, you might be told that you have to expect people with this sort of learning level, and you might be ending up dealing with people of a different group altogether. So we have to be prepared to face any kind of audience so that at the end of the day, we don't make a mess out of anything. And third is to create an agenda based on participants' experience levels. If you're conducting events, say for a group of biology students, it's good that you help them edit articles related to biology so that they can relate more to the article. So the agenda should be always based on what kind of participants you're looking at. Also, if you're looking at a beginner audience, it's better to give them articles which are really very simple and not going to complicated ones, do not ask them to edit like long articles which are like controversial. Again, we should spend generous amount of time for hands-on workshops because lecturing stuff doesn't make you acquainted with the open source project you are working in. Like I can lecture for like maybe hours and hours, but you don't pick up anything. But if you do a hands-on workshop, it will really make people to understand what they are doing, and they might start asking questions, and that's how you get a more level of engagement. And it's always very difficult to figure out what learning resources will be useful for your audience. So the best thing is to ask them to learn by experimenting. You give them their options, like tell them that this is how you edit, teach them the basics, and ask them to work on it on their own. So in the process, they'll be learning on their own. They'll be finding new opportunities. They'll be finding problems which they can't tackle, which they'll be asking you, and you will be answering them. Second is to give them cheat sheets and workbooks and show them how to do videos and so on. On Wikipedia, we do have a really good cheat sheet which helps them to go into the process of editing very easily. And workbooks will do. I haven't tried them. And yeah, we can give links to videos which explains the process of editing and make them, you know, acquainted to the editing process. As a mentor, it will be useful to maintain a list of resources so that you can choose what resource to give to which person and so on. If you have a list, it's helpful because you don't have to search it every time. You don't have to search the whole of the internet every time to find out what resource will be appropriate for you. So whenever you see a web page or a video which you think is good, make a note of it so that you can use it in the next workshop you're doing. Again, in choosing learning resources, the few things which I always look into are, like, it should be brief. If you're going to give them a very lengthy piece of writing, asking them to read and find out what to do, people are not going to read it, and they are just going to discard it, and they will discontinue it at that point. So your learning resource has to be brief. And again, it has to be well comprehensible. If you're putting it in very complicated language, your volunteers are not going to understand. So it has to be very comprehensible. And it would be better if it's illustrated with lots of pictures and screenshots so that the whole thing is made very easy for them. Again, if it is possible to get it in the local language or in the language of their choice, it would be additionally advantageous because that's the language which they can relate the mostly relate mostly to. Now that we have taught, we have found them and taught them, we have to keep them engaged, which is also a hard task. What I do to engage people is to collect their usernames and contact details at the end of the event, only if they are willing to give it to me. And it's always okay to not give their usernames or contact details or whatever. But if they are willing to give it to me, I'll definitely keep them. I'll have a spreadsheet of them so that I can contact them later on, asking for suggestions or maybe asking to come to the next event and so on. It's important to keep them in loop in discussions centering around your project. So you can make them subscribe to the mailing list. You can ask them to subscribe to the mailing list of your project, and so that all the discussions happen in their presence and they can also contribute their points into it. Then the ideal thing is to have a one-to-one mentorship. Like if you are a mentor, you mentor just one person. But that is not going to, I mean, you mentor like one person, which is actually not going to happen. It's only the ideal situation, but it's good if you keep the numbers really low so that you can give your quality time to most of the volunteers you are mentoring. Also, it is a good thing to assign activities, like you are setting up a task which your volunteer should finish in a week or so. Like you give them an article which they should be cleaning up in a week, which makes them like feel like wanting being in a doing their stuff in a time-bound fashion. So that really helps in engaging, because they know that they have to finish it within maybe the next weekend or so. So all these activities do really help. Now about recognizing your volunteers. So if you go on giving them tasks and make them do things, it's almost certain that they get exhausted. So you have got to encourage them. So I think recognition is the best way. Recognizing them, not by giving money, but by giving other sort of recognitions, which really matters to them. I don't know how far this is feasible outside, but in Wikipedia, I have found that people do really care about being recognized. So on Wikipedia, we have this thing called WikiLove, which is basically a code which we paste on their user talk pages, which says like good things about them, which makes them very happy and which makes them want to contribute more. So, and there are like barn stars, which are basically stars. If you see a person doing a good job, we give them a barn star saying that, okay, this is a good job you made. And that's how we keep them engaging. Next, I used to coordinate this particular project called the Featured Volunteer of the Month. So there is a wiki for the Wikimedia India chapter where I'm volunteering with. So in the main page of Wikipedia, there would appear the profile of a featured volunteer. You select featured volunteers of the month, not based on their level of activity, but based on what kind of engagement, what amount of time they give into their project. Say for example, it's not about generating a lot of content, it's about what amount of time they spend on the project. So we do have the featured volunteer, and that being featured makes them very proud, and that makes them continue to volunteer. It's helpful to give certificates and letters of reference when they are asked for. So we have had a few people join a particular editathon, and all these people did a good job, and they have wanted me to write a letter to their potential employer, telling them that they have participated in this editathon and they have created all these articles. So that works. If a conference is happening in the locality which is aligned to their level of interest, we could probably give them the conference passes for free. That will also help the conference organizers, because we are giving them an attendee who is passionate about volunteering and who has some level of knowledge about that conference. It's also good to give free access to resources, especially if you are coming from a very resource poor setting. So on Wikipedia we have this project called Books and Bytes, which basically looks at connecting big journals with Wikimedia volunteers, and the journals will give away their memberships for free for say a year or so to Wikimedia contributors who are active in projects of their choice. For example, if you are running a medical journal and you will give like 100 memberships to volunteers who are actively writing articles in medicine. So that will help the volunteers to be more engaged because they get access to a lot of resources, and using these resources they can write articles of their choice. It is also helpful to give them media recognition, because when suppose you are a volunteer you mentored is conducting an event, and if you are putting it in the newspaper, the volunteer will be very happy. Everybody will be seeing the newspaper, and it gives them a lot of fame. So putting on the media will also help. Again, about the motivations of a volunteer, I've asked people what motivates you, and people, and in the previous slide I've been talking about the values they motivated, and these are about things like which probably motivates them, I don't really know. And volunteers have always been happy in getting stuff like swags, like t-shirts and label pins and bags, and I don't know how far they have giving these have helped them in sustaining their level of activity. People have been generally happy in getting all these swags. I don't know if they act as a motivation to them, but volunteers are generally happy to know that, you know, to get swags of maybe the Wikimedia or Mozilla or whatever project they are working with. Again, surprise gifts really matter. I think the Mozilla Foundation usually sends t-shirts to its volunteers. So one fine morning, you find that you have been couriered a good t-shirt with the Mozilla emblem on it, and that makes you happy for the whole week, and you use it everywhere. So it really makes many people happy, many volunteers happy. Then we could conduct volunteer meetups where all the volunteers of one particular locality meet up together. They talk about the projects of their choice, and that helps them in hanging out with their friends, so which motivates them a lot. It is also good to give travel scholarships, especially in Wikipedia. We do have a travel scholarship program where basically volunteers can apply for a scholarship to participate in a conference and so on. That also motivates them to volunteer because in the conference of their they get to participate in the conference of their choice, which is also aligned to the Wikimedia movement, and they also get to build a lot of contacts. Again, some people are motivated to volunteer because of the internship opportunities that is being opened up by that particular open knowledge project. Say, for example, if you are if you want to be an intern at the outreach program of event, you are first asked to submit a micro task. A micro task is a very small task which you should be submitting in order to be eligible to be an outreach program of women intern. So you can't just get into the internship directly without having any experience. You need to have at least a small experience. So to gain experience in order to be an intern makes people want to volunteer. Now this is a very interesting question. Not everybody whom you have mentored becomes a volunteer all the time. Say in my editathons, the retention rate would be like 10%, maybe 10 to 20%, depending upon which editathon you're looking at. So I have asked people why they have been quitting to volunteer, and I've got all these, you know, answers. For some, it's like lack of sustained motivation. They keep writing articles, they keep doing a lot of work, but they don't get motivated sufficiently enough and they quit. Secondly, it's the fighty culture and the poor conflict resolution. This is somewhat true for Wikipedia, where if you are looking into writing articles which are of controversial nature, you will have to get to fight to be able to put your point of view into it. So it becomes very fighty, and sometimes you have people using abusive language, even publicly, which makes some people very tired of contributing and they do quit. Then there is this problem of not recognizing the contributions sufficiently. On Malayalam language Wikipedia, I have written articles about articles related to microbiology, about cultivating bacteria, and I have been like very prolifically editing all those pages, and there was nobody to read them. Nobody reads all my articles about. Nobody wants to cultivate bacteria, and nobody reads it. So I got discouraged about, you know, continuing doing it because nobody's recognizing my articles, and I quit it. So probably there are also people who write articles and whose articles are not sufficiently recognized, and they do quit. Then there is this problem of an unwelcoming culture. In your outreach programs, you say that it's really very lovely to be able to volunteer. You get a lot of cool people who will be hanging out and so on. But when they actually get into the project, they might not be as welcome as they thought. They were very welcome in their setting, I mean in the workshop setting, but they may not be as welcome in their in the real project. So the unwelcoming culture puts off some people. Then there is this problem of a disorganized work culture. Like you don't know what you are doing something, and there is another person also doing something, so you are essentially duplicating the work, which is like a waste of time. So if you are like doing disorganized stuff, your volunteers might quit. Then there are personal reasons which you might not be able to do anything about, like people are moving out of the city, or people are getting a new job and they don't have any more time to be able to volunteer, so they do go. Managing your volunteers. So as I said in the previous slides, it would be good to create a volunteering spreadsheet with names and contact details of all volunteers you met during a particular edit-a-thon or a particular event, so that you will be able to reach out to them at a later point of time. It's also important to have adequate interval between events. You can't go on conducting events like every 2 weeks. So the adequate time, I would say that it would be like 2 months. So if the same participant has to attend a meetup or a workshop happening like every weekend or every 2 weeks, in every 2 weeks, they are not going to show up all the time. Again, maintaining a list of participants is important. And also, most of your volunteers would want to keep in touch with you on social media. I don't really know if it's good or bad, but when what I do is I keep them tagged as in a separate circle. On Google Plus, I keep them in a separate circle. On Facebook, I mark them as acquaintances, and I keep them I keep a track of them as, you know, a separate group, so that you will not know the names of all of them. You will not be remembering where you met them. So when they ask you questions, you will be confused as to where you met them and who they are and so on. So to avoid that and to recognize that they were the volunteer you mentored, it's essential that you should mark them as volunteers, because unless people take a lot of offense if you do not recognize them. Because you are conducting a lot of events, and it will be hard for you to remember everyone personally. But those people do really take a lot of offense if we don't recognize them. So it's important that when you are adding them on social media, it's good to know that they are from this particular workshop you have done. It's also important to ensure diversity. There is no point in having a project if you do not have diverse group of participants. So for this, I do workshop for targeted groups, just like, you know, workshops for women and workshops for journalists, workshop for bloggers and so on. So you can have like a variety of participants coming in from many different backgrounds, and your project can have like a diversity of participants. It's also important to ensure a safe space policy, as I told before, just like an anti-harassment policy. Again, the trainers, like the mentors, should ideally be from a variety of backgrounds. And also it's important to have a code of conduct. And again, burnouts do happen. So like as a trainer, I have had so many burnouts many times. I was at my personal low at many times, but I think the best thing to fight burnouts is to take a break in between and maybe look into the same project with a different perspective at a later time and fight burnouts and so on. Thank you very much for listening. I think we have too little time for questions, but I would definitely take them. I'm so sorry for being like, you know, very quick and moving on. So I would definitely like questions or maybe any comments or any ideas, any new ideas. I do this in India. I do offline workshops and online workshops. Offline workshops are like you do it in real time. You meet your volunteers. It's happening in a room like this, and you talk with them and so on. When you conduct online workshops, it's like it's open to anyone. So people from the US can join, people from maybe Africa or Australia or wherever they are, irrespective of their location, they can join in and they can edit articles together. And all the style guides and all how to do's, everything will be on the internet. And people could just look up that and start writing articles on their own.
So have you had success with recruiting volunteers that are not from India, that are in some other country that you've never met personally?
Yes. I have had friends from, I've been working with like multiple projects at the same time. Like I've also had friends who are studying in medical schools outside of the country. I've been managing TED Talks, so I have had another set of friends who are like from that group, who are not actually in contact with me each other, who are not living in the same city as I do. But they have heard about Wikipedia, and when they have wanted to volunteer with Wikipedia, and so I give them links about the next online edit-a-thon, which is happening, and they are like looking up and they are starting to edit and they ask me questions. Sometimes we do run an IRC, or once we have done a Google Hangout with whoever is interested in volunteering, and we do it. But that is really very difficult. It's really very difficult to sit in one city and mentor a person who is sitting in another city. So the best thing I always try to do is to connect them with a volunteer who is local to them. Say, if you have someone who wants to volunteer to Wikipedia and he's living in Portland, you make him meet another person who is also in Portland so that they will have sort of a real life conversation about what is editing and so on.